Did y'all taste those new hamburgers they had down there?
Slash and pickle.
Gonna be good. The shrimp po' boy. The hamburgers gonna be good.
Alright, let's get started.
They gonna be good.
Alright, back.
Here we go.
I see you're wearing your golfing shoes today.
Yeah.
Oh, he sure does.
If you like lamb, they're gonna have lamb burgers. I don't like lamb.
Everybody signed in?
One with lamb and one with steak.
One with lamb.
You know that word?
Yeah,
one gonna have a lamb burger.
Alright, y'all ready?
Yeah.
Alright. My name is Dominic McClendon, most of y'all know. I attend the University of Tennessee Health Science Center, and I'm completing my MLT to MLS online bachelor program. Mm-hmm. And the last class was advanced practices, and it was basically about management in the lab, education, ethics, and the main topic was a research paper. My topic of choice was sample contamination. It's pretty prevalent in the lab, so I thought I'd do some research and find out more stuff for myself. So, as we all know, lab results are kind of the pivotal point in healthcare. That's how doctors, they may have an idea of what's going on, but when they get those lab results, then they know how to take action. So lab results are really important. They're downplayed sometimes, but the doctors and nurses need them. Today I'm specifically talking about contamination with patients that have PICC lines, peripheral inserted central catheters, mostly the real critical patients who can't eat on their own, who can't receive nutrients via mouth. So I thought, what should be done, what should we do? I felt like if I can do research and implement a plan that we can present to all members of the staff, nurses, doctors, lab technicians, just on the importance of sample contamination and the risks involved behind it. All right, sample contamination is the topic, and that's what we're talking about. So I felt like, okay, let me back up. Masks are worn to conceal somebody's identity. We wear them at masquerade balls. We wear them around Halloween. We wear them in the lab to protect ourselves from injury, harm, danger, or death. So patients, ICU, critical care, and cancer patients often have their blood masks, not as an amusement, but masks from contamination of if they're having anything going through their line. They receive the PICC line so they can readily receive life-sustaining IV fluids. However, if an improper and unsuitable lab is collected by the IV line, it'll replace the true blood sample. And if it's accidentally ran and reported out, then we got a problem. These patients are already under critical supervision, and timely patient care is essential. When we have a contaminated sample, it stops the process. We have to do a recollect, and who knows how long a recollect takes. Chemistry, blood bank if it's clotted, micro if it's, you know, if it's collected wrong, sent to the lab wrong, we have to recollect them. Here at Methodist University, we have a pretty big bed count, and we have a wild population. We have a cancer unit, a transplant unit, ICU, stroke patients, and surgical ICU. Reiterating, between 70 and 80% of clinical-based decisions are off laboratory results. It may be 70-80, but our goal is 100% on accuracy and precision when we want to report out answers, especially if it's going to go towards treating a patient. As techs, our pre-analytical tasks are usually we check, make sure the names match on labels, making sure the amount is sufficient for testing. And after we spin it, we can see if it's hemolyzed or enteric, anything like that, if it needs to be recollected. Once we run it, we don't know what's gonna happen once the results come across. And that's usually when we find out if a sample has been compromised by contamination. So now I just wanna talk about the most common contaminants that we found in chemistry. The first one is ethylene diamine titriacetacid, EDTA. Mm-hmm. Total parental nutrition. Fluids. Dextrose or D5. Mm-hmm. Antibiotics. And medicines. First one, EDTA. It's found usually in CBC top tubes, used to chelate calcium. And if a sample is used in chemistry that has EDTA contamination, it'll increase potassium plasma concentration, reduce calcium, reduce magnesium, and reduce alkaline phosphatase. And that's kind of how we can figure out if it's contaminated or not. For example, if we have a patient on the floor that has a critical low potassium and somebody either collects it out of order or decided to take a purple top and pour into a green top, mm-hmm. it'll spike that potassium almost greater than 10 or just high. And instead, if they got a 1.2 or a 2.2 potassium and it spikes it up to a normal, then the patient isn't treating, they're sitting down there in pain. Mm-hmm. If the potassium is low, it can lead to cardiac arrhythmias, leading to death almost. So it's really important. Next one, I group them all together is TPN, dextrose, and Clinimix. All of them basically contain some type of glucose, but other things are involved as well. TPN is a method of feeding that bypasses the GI tract, providing nutrients to the body when one can't receive feedings or fluids by mouth. D5 is a simple sugar that is chemically identical to glucose. It is dissolved in a solution that are given intravenously, which can be combined with other drugs and used to increase the person's blood sugar. And the last is Clinimix.
Hiya, Nelson. Without extension 68622.
Clinimix is amino acid and dextrose mix, so it's pretty much the same thing, just has amino acids and proteins in it. Next contaminant is IV fluids. Depending on the patient's condition, they may receive just normal saline or a specific analyte, maybe a bolus of magnesium, potassium, whatever the patient needs. Also, the PICC line, they flush it to clean it out, and that's another way it's contaminated. If they flush it and they collect the sample right after flushing, then that sample is going to be diluted out. It's no good. And lastly, but not least, it's antibiotics, medication, and chemotherapy. Antibiotics such as vancomycin, we know it's a really strong antibiotic, so that has to be monitored because the therapeutic index, if it gets out of control in the body, can be toxic to the patient. So if a nurse administers an antibiotic and pulls right from the same line, we're just pulling the drug right back out. So that sample's no good. And also, chemotherapy, the drug FK506, it's been a study shown that that drug can linger around in the line for 5 to 7 days. So I got all my data from mid-September to mid-October, and I kind of arranged it according to patient floor, collector, and the contaminants of concern. I found out that TPN was the cause of about 50% of sample interference. I think that's because it's so easy to catch, because you can get a glucose that's ranging from 1,500 to 2,000. We know that's not right. They'll never have a spike. They'll never have a spike glucose. Nurses dominated the collecting population of collected contaminated blood samples with over 50%. Mm-hmm. And the cancer unit experienced the majority of recollects as well as multiple recollects. Mm-hmm. So here's my data. I broke it down to in a pie chart. Slight blue, mm-hmm. this green, this kind of teal were all falling in the TPN, D5, Clinimix, lipids profile, so it's mm-hmm. more over 50%. The purple is IV flush when they clean it and don't do a discard tube. 10% was EDTA. 5% was maybe if they gave them a bolus of magnesium. Mm-hmm. And 5 of them was normal saline, and 12% was like a bolus of magnesium, a specific analyte. Mm-hmm. I also grouped how long it would take to recollect a contaminated sample. from less than an hour, only 9%. 31% was from 1 to 2 hours. The majority was a 3 to 5 window, which was 40%, and my greater than 5 hours was 20%, but that 5 hours went all the way up to 24 hours before they recollected.
Wow.
And depending on the patient, most of these patients were critical. That's way too long. So then I got to who did it.
Uh-oh.
So, on the cancer unit, mostly the nurses collect. This was out of 41 patients, I'm sorry. The nurses dominated the cancer unit. On the tower, it was nurses dominating again. Mm-hmm. The yellow stands for when they scribble on the tube and we can't tell if it was a nurse or a lab collect. Mm-hmm. And the green is the phlebotomist. Mm-hmm. So this is tower, ICU, transplant, and over there in the corner is ED, mm-hmm. nurses, and that orange is the paramedics wanting some action, and they also collected contaminated specimens. Mm-hmm. So after all the data, I want to implement a nice little plan that the phlebotomist can get in service, but Ms. Renee had already had that in progress, and she created a checklist to come to chemistry and understand what happens when we get a short sample, a contaminated sample, how do we know it's EDT contaminated, and all that good stuff. So then after that was given to them, I compiled data from October 15th through November 1st. The in-service happened between the 13th and the 14th. And it was a pretty good change. Out of 25 patients, 82% were still nurses, only 18% were phlebotomists, and none of the phlebotomist collects were EDTA contaminated.
Dominic, did any of the nurses ever say this?
No.
Well, that explains a lot.
In conclusion, I think the getting rid of contamination is going to take some time and some effort. Compliance and continued education and modifications the more we learn. We also have to work together with the nurses in the lab to understand what's going on the floor, and they need to understand what's going on in the lab instead of just having a battle of who's right and who's wrong. Even though hemolyzed samples, lipemic, enteric samples are very common and we know what to do with those, recollect hemolyzed, lipemic, enteric, we can't help it, that's the body's function. But when we get a contaminated sample with an interference, we can help that. We can do things to change the way we collect it, the way we analyze it, and we can eliminate the reporting and reporting of it so better treatment can be issued to help these patients. Because at the end of the day, we're here to save patients, not hinder, hurt, kill them. And thank you for your time. Any questions?
With the FK506, the chemotherapy treatment that you said lingers for 5 to 7 days, that's almost a week. So were they erroneously elevated or were they lowered by that?
Elevated.
Okay.
Because they would clear the line, take them off the drug, and it was still in the line. It would still be in the blood sample as they collected the food.
So with those patients, are they only to moderate once a week or?
Well, when they was doing the study, I think they was trying to do it every day to see how much of it would linger behind before it was completely cleared from the line. More questions?
So when you talked about the fluids that were in there, were the samples elevated or lowered with the different kinds of solutions?
From a flush, it'll be diluted. We'll get those 1.2 potassium, 0.9 magnesium, things that just don't make sense. And if it's a bolus where they gave them potassium, then it'll just be
I think this is a presentation for Patient Safety Wednesday.
I think it would be really good too, don't you?
What you see in the lab, they don't see point of care. They do the same testing with the same stuff and they get screwed off. It does not compute.
Okay. Because I found out about 6 months ago that the satellites put all theirs in Safeguard. So I put in Safeguard for every single one.